and other things. Now, rapid industrialization is also another problem, where due to rapid industrialization, what happens is basically the resources, natural resources, are consumed very fast. There is depletion of resources, what we say, and thus the environmental values say that we need to be very compassionate towards the nature, the wildlife, the animals, okay, and other raw material and other resources. Okay, so today we are going to discuss about business ethics and environmental values. Okay, so what is environmental ethics? We are going to try to understand. So, it is a branch of applied ethics which examines moral basis of environmental responsibility. See, it is a responsibility of every citizen on land, okay, in this world, to be basically compassionate towards the environment. Okay, so environmental ethics is applied ethics. In day-to-day life, we have to think and just see whether we are exhausting the raw material, whether we are being harsh with the trees, animals, okay, and how we are, what efforts we are making to protect the environment. Environmental responsibilities have to be weighed against responsibilities to stakeholders and societal benefits. Okay, so human beings just cannot run towards behind technology and profits, okay, to make their businesses successful. Human beings are main stakeholders in the society, and they should look towards protecting the environment and not damaging the environment. Okay, so these we are important stakeholders in the society. It is our moral responsibility to protect our natural environment. So the study of how to protect this natural environment is environmental ethics. Okay, so these days, whenever you get holiday, you crave, isn't it? It is so hot here in district of Solapur. Let's go to a hill station where we can find nature, okay, and greenery. And those say if you get holidays for 2 days also, you plan a trip with your family saying that I want to spend time where there is good nature and I will get fresh oxygen to be breathe, good air to breathe, okay, the environment is good. So I'm tired of this city life where there is heavy pollution. So this is particularly where environment is conserved, greenery is conserved, people are following ethics and they are protecting the environment. Okay, so this is environmental ethics. Then one more definition you can take down. Environmental ethics is the philosophical discipline that considers the moral and ethical relationship of human beings to the environment. It is a relationship between human beings and environment. See, on this planet, Earth planet, only human beings are having intelligence. Okay? So animals don't deteriorate the quality of environment on Earth. Or plants also don't do it. Mostly it is animals, people who are having intelligence, and with the use of this artificial intelligence and other things, they are basically spoiling the environment, which is not ethical. So, in other words, what if any moral obligation does man have to preservation and care of non-human world? Okay, so see, we take care of ourselves. Okay, even if a pin pricks us, we are basically unhappy. Okay, we are in tears. So we try to protect our external being and internal selves. But what about the human world, non-human world, that is trees or animals or maybe the soil? Okay, then we are using artificial methods to get more comfort day by day. And for this comfort, where big cars are running on the road, you want to use the cars, you want to play video games, you want to basically use technology from all point of view, but at the cost of spoiling the environment, which is not ethical. Okay, so the study of preservation of environment is environmental ethics. Then next we have to see what is pollution. Okay, so this chapter deals also with regard to ethics in minimizing pollution on earth, and how what are the ill causes of pollution, and how basically the earth is getting depleted with natural resources due to pollution. Pollution is the undesirable contamination of environment by the manufacturer or use of commodities. Okay, so what is the meaning of undesirable contamination is that when you run a manufacturing industry, maybe the smoke is coming out. Okay, then basically what smoke is emitted from the industry pollutes the air. Okay, it increases the temperature also, and whatever contaminated air is there around, the people are breathing it. Okay, with more of carbon content and less of oxygen, and which is not good for human body, and he is basically getting more diseases. Okay, experiencing more diseases, and like asthma, okay, or even these viral infections like COVID and other things. All this is happening because of pollution. So it is, and what is pollution? It is undesirable contamination of environment, okay, by industry or other commodities. Okay, unnatural commodities. So environment ethics, there are three approaches concerning moral responsibility of environment. So first is anthropocentrism. Okay, then is anxiological approach, and third is ecocentric approach. So we are going to see what are these one after the other. Anthropocentrism approach focuses on the utility that human beings can derive by protecting the environment. Okay, so if you cut trees, you get certain utility in the form of say using the wood to as a energy resource. Okay, you can burn the wood and you can cook. Okay, so this is particularly on one side, you are cutting the forest, and on the other side, you are making your life more say comfortable. Okay, by using this natural resources. So this particular approach of anthropocentrism says conserve trees and particularly protect the environment, reduce natural resources as utility for human beings. So since the survival and well-being of human beings depends on the environment, It is moral responsibility of human beings to support and preserve the environment. So just for having a comfortable life, you cannot spoil the nature. Okay? Man basically, he is not bothered about the natural resources, but with the help of technology and other modern trends, he wants to make his life more and more comfortable day by day. So this is not a moral value. Okay? You are responsible human beings and you have to preserve the environment instead of utilizing the natural resources which are going to exhaust one day or the other. Okay? The population of the country is increasing day by day. If all people run behind natural resources, industry wants natural resources, human beings want to cut trees and use for cooking at home, okay, as a resource. So everybody is running behind natural resources, utilization of natural resources, and this is going to particularly harm the environment. And this is the study of anthropocentric approach. Okay, so under this, you may have forest resources, water resources, then air pollution, all these kind of things. Okay, next is anxiological approach. According to anxiological approach, it is the moral responsibility to protect animals. Okay, so these days we read in newspapers that even in cosmetics, animal fats are used. Okay, and the ivory tusks, so many beautiful articles are made out of ivory tusks. Then animal skin is used. Then oil of particular animals extracts are also used. So this is all basically harming the animal species. Wildlife conservation, we have bird sanctuaries, we have animal sanctuaries created to protect the species. Now we can count on our fingertips how many lions are there and how many tigers are there. Okay, the number is reducing day by day, and basically this is because unethical practices are adopted by businessmen to earn profit through these animals, killing of these innocent animals. So this particular anxiological approach says that it is ethical to have an approach to protect the animals rather than utilizing them for business purpose. Okay, it implies the responsibility of environment with regard to preservation of animals and animal rights. Okay, so animals are also living beings. Even they have a right to survive, live on this earth happily. But what is man doing? He is taking undue advantage. He is killing animals and basically utilizing them for profit purposes. So this is unethical. Okay, so first approach and second approach we have seen. Third is ecocentric approach. It is considered to be a radical approach to environmental responsibility. The theory states that environment has to be influenced from direct moral consideration. Okay, we talk of eco-friendliness, isn't it? Use of consumed or material which can be easily disposed of, use of eco-friendly cloth bags or paper bags rather than plastic bags. Okay, so it is similar to that. So it is our moral responsibility to be friendly with our environment. Eco-centric approach means be friendly with your environment, and basically don't just be self-centered in terms of running your industry and polluting the environment. So these are three approaches for environment. Then next we are going to see what are environmental issues. Okay, what are the problems in the environment? So where there is no strong governing body for formulating and implementing an environment policy, and where there is lack of adequate environmental expertise, technology and resources for environment protection and environment degradation go unchecked. Okay, what does this mean? If your basic running ruling government does not make policies to protect the environment, then definitely these aspects are neglected. Okay, you are only running behind development of the country, improving GDP of the country, then basically increasing the revenue from various sectors, but this particular environmental issues are totally neglected. So this is what is realized by many of the countries, okay, that environment needs to be protected. Now what has happened due to neglecting the natural resource conservation in Western Europe, we are going to see. As businesses expanded, the issues concerned with environment started gaining importance. Most Western European countries have faced problems due to environment degradation. Okay, so see, Europe comes under advanced countries. Europe, US, okay, Germany, Japan, these are all advanced countries. And they went in for rapid industrialization initially without thinking of degradation of the environment, and they have started facing problem with natural resources. For instance, example we can see, Netherlands has had to face industrial pollution due to the dumping of industrial waste and the release of hazardous chemical into the rivers. Okay, so due to rapid industrialization, what is happening? Pollution is increasing, industrial pollution is increasing, and industries are dumping their waste into the rivers, and chemical hazards also is dumped into the rivers, polluting the water, and human beings are experiencing a variety of diseases because of this pollution in Western Europe. Okay, now let's see the situation in India. Rapid industrialization and urbanization have brought about economic development in India, but they also cause damage to country's environment through deforestation, soil erosion, and water pollution. Okay, so what is deforestation? Yes, anybody, can we discuss? Can we make the session interactive? Anybody will tell me what is deforestation, soil erosion?
What yes, please give the answers, students.
Yes. Anybody would like to answer?
No idea, ma'am.
Yes.
I don't know.
200.10.20.0 से लेके 200.10.20.127.
So data okay, please give the answers.
यहाँ पे या
Yes, student. Am I audible?
Yes, decreasing yes, the number sir. Of trees by human. It
yes. Correct. Go on. And what is soil erosion? Soil erosion is contamination of quality of soil. Okay. So earlier you used to get a very fresh and green crop on black soil in the fields. But today there is degradation of the soil. And the yield or the crops that are coming are hybrid and basically they are not natural and good for health. Okay. So this is contamination or degradation of quality of soil. Have you followed? Students? Shall we continue?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. The Environmental Protection Act 1986 focused on reducing industrial pollution. The report stated that estimated annual cost of environmental degradation is 4.5% of GDP average. Okay? So, GDP is gross domestic product. So, out of the total, generally it is around 9% annually in India. So, in India it is observed that out of this particular, the GDP on one side is increasing, but if GDP has increased by 10%, the environmental degradation is by 4.5%. Okay, so it is now mandatory. If you think of future, it has become compulsory for the government to pass these kind of laws, Environmental Protection Act, for the industry. Okay, and there is inspection from government authorities to see that industries, whether industries are following all the environmental laws or not. Okay, or they are still degrading the particular environment. So this is the situation in India. Many of the particular cities, they have been declared as more most polluted cities, okay, in the world. So we have to be very careful in future. Okay, then next, the types of particular pollution that is going happening in the environment, how environment is being degraded. We are going to see first with air pollution. According to World Health Organization environmental report, New Delhi is one of the top 10 most polluted cities in the world. Okay. Sometimes when there is fog and pollution together, there are many car accidents because you cannot see due to fog, and especially in this winter season, due to fog and pollution, you cannot see the cars running around you, and there is lot of possibility of accidents which are occurring in New Delhi. Then air pollution is of two types, vehicular emission and untreated industrial smoke. Okay, so why what are the causes of air pollution? One side, too many vehicles are running on roads emitting carbon. Okay, so due to this emission or carbon emission, pollution, air pollution is occurring, and untreated industrial smoke. So many industries are coming up, and during the manufacturing process, they are coming out with industrial smoke, which is polluting the air around us. Okay, then to curb vehicular emission, the Supreme Court of India has laid down two rules. All public vehicles that are 15 or more than 15 years old should be banned on road. Okay, so this is the latest rule, because as the vehicle goes on becoming older and older, more carbon is emitted and the level of pollution becomes very high. And these days, because a number of automobile industries are entering in India, we have, after globalization, we have all foreign automobile manufacturing industries coming to our countries. The number of four-wheelers, two-wheelers on the roads are increasing day by day. So now to control air pollution, vehicle, four-wheelers, which are more than 15 years old, you have to either exchange with new vehicle or you have to stop using it on roads. Okay. Public transport vehicles in New Delhi should switch over to compressed natural gas. Okay. CNG engines. Okay. So these are certain methods to reduce the air pollution. Now, next we'll see energy consumption and carbon emission. India is the second largest commercial energy consumer in non-OECD, East Asia, accounting for 19% of total primary energy consumption. So what are these resources of energy consumption? Petrol, oil, okay, hydroelectricity. These are all particularly unnatural sources of energy consumption. And in the total world, 19% of the energy is consumed by India, okay, as population is very high. 60% of the energy needs are met by commercial energy and non-conventional and renewable fuels meet 40% of the energy needs. See, renewable energy and non-renewable energy. Energy resources which are going to get exhausted, okay? They are non-renewable energy, okay? So once they get exhausted, like trees and all, forests, once they get exhausted, there is no source of renovation or renewal. But there are certain renewable energy sources like solar and all. So now instead of running petrol cars, government is thinking of bringing electric cars, electric motorbikes on roads, so that there is less carbon emitted by petrol cars, diesel cars, and you can run the cars on electricity by charging. Okay, so this is the point for renewable and non-renewable energy resources. Increase in population and urbanization is attributed to high energy consumption in industrial escort. As the population increases, the MIDCs are increasing, the number of industries are increasing, and more energy is being consumed by people. Okay, so this is regarding energy consumption by industries. Okay, resource consumption by industries and particularly pollution, carbon emission. Now, energy and carbon intensity. Carbon intensity levels are high in India when compared to other Asian countries. Okay, so we like to take a ride in the car. We like to use these four-wheelers, but we are not bothered that to use these units, carbon protection units, or buying these units to stop emission of carbon from our cars. So due to this reason, the carbon intensity or emission of carbon is at highest level in India out of all the Asian countries. Asia is the biggest continent in the world, and we are having lot of vehicles and carbon emission. The reasons for this are the increase in industrial activity that has taken place due to economic expansion, okay, and the absence of energy conservation measures in most industrial areas. So on one side, there is rapid industrialization due to globalization, then joint ventures, okay, MNCs are coming to our country. So rapid industrialization is there, and on another side, there are no measures for energy conservation. So this is the state of India. Now next we have a picture of Bhopal gas tragedy. See, government of India and Union Carbide from US together, they started a chemical plant in Bhopal, and due to some mistake, the poisonous gas leaked, okay, out of the plant. It was a chemical industry, and when the poisonous gas has leaked in the environment, the effects of this, at that time many people lost their lives because of this poisonous gas. In lakhs people have lost their lives, but even today the ill effects of this chemical are being experienced. Like old age people are having breathing problems, pregnant mothers are not giving birth to good children, okay, so by inhaling this poisonous gas. So this is one of the example of unethical practice adopted by industry. If you are running a chemical factory, you need to take all the precaution, okay, to see that this kind of negligence does not occur, okay. This happened because one of the workers forgot to close the tap of a particular container which was having poisonous gas. But this kind of negligence is intolerable, and basically there was a lot of good relationship between India and US. That is, Union Carbide is from US, so this collateral relation between the two countries, they started spoiling because of this Bhopal gas tragedy. And the Union Carbide company wanted to break away the joint venture with Indian government, okay. So this is the example of unethical practices due to the chemical industry. Now what is required is greening, okay. When a company adopts an anti-pollution environment policy, it is said to be going green, okay. Organization adopt green initiatives due to the following reasons. See, greening is like, you know, we took example of Toyota company. So when this Toyota company is manufacturing cars, it is accepted that tomorrow this car is going to run on the road and emit carbon. So it is compulsory for these automobile industries to plant trees, okay, and go green. So organizations take initiatives due to following reasons. First is economic benefit from increased efficiency, okay. So particularly the companies, they can make more profit. Today if you say that a car is having particular environmental protection unit, or it is more eco-friendly, more people will come and purchase. So economic benefit is there to the company. Then competitive advantage through innovation. Okay, so today automobile industry cannot survive without innovation. They have to come out with eco-friendly techniques, okay, to sell the cars in the market. And third is public image. Okay, so going green gives you a good brand name in the industry, in the country. Okay, so greening today is compulsory, mandatory for the industries. Then what are the green initiatives? Green initiatives in business range from environmentally friendly technologies, innovation, green tourism, green community, environment, environmentally engaging, and environmental connecting. Okay, so counseling also is there. So these are certain initiatives taken for going green. Okay, so industries have to adopt all these things, that is environmental friendly technological innovations. Okay, so when you adopt new technology, you should see that it will not harm the environment. Like we were discussing about e-waste. So due to technology, the use of computers, the use of technological equipment is increasing day by day. But how to basically the innovation is happening, new technologies entering, but one side due to e-waste, there is pollution and there is other aspects. Then green tourism. Okay, so like Kerala is considered heaven on earth. Okay, so you have to keep on preserving the greenery on the earth, and with this green tourism initiatives you can preserve the environment and green community. Okay, and environmental campaigning. Okay, and environmental counseling. Through these initiatives you can counsel your employees, you can counsel your staff, okay, to maintain greenery around you. Then next is green tourism. It is commonly found in UK and continental Europe. Some organizations have a practice of offering convention holidays and tours, and the amount collected from such packages is used for donation to green organizations or charity. Okay, so there are activists or there are social groups, NGOs, who are working for environmental protection. So in what they do in UK or Europe, whenever there is a practice, whenever they get holiday, they don't have festivals much, but they go out of the house for tours. So whatever money is collected from these packages, part of it is spent for greening the environment. Then the government also encourages those people who are interested in preserving the landscapes. Okay, so this is how the green tourism is encouraged in foreign countries. Then we have the concept of environmental counseling. It is a green program aimed at encouraging employees to express their concerns about environmental issues. Okay, in many countries, employees are given an opportunity to discuss environmental issues. Okay, so small things like in your day-to-day life also, due to lack of greenery, what problems you are facing. Okay, the moisture is there, you are sweating more, the heat has increased, especially in summer season. So you can basically discuss all these environmental issues on a common platform and try to find solutions. Companies also publish articles on green topics and organize competitions to encourage ecologically sensitive innovation in working processes. See, when inter-college competitions are there on essay or paper presentation, these issues are taken. You see that picture, isn't it? Earth is there in green hands and other things. So, through these particularly activities also, the message can be spread how to conserve the environment. Then, a survey conducted by Business Today and Tata Energy Research Institute focused on two aspects: environmental reactivity and identification of the greenest companies in terms of maturity of their environmental systems and practices. So these two particular, Business Today is a magazine and Tata Energy Research Institute, they have conducted survey and identified companies who are having good green practices in their day-to-day operations. A variety of aspects and policies of organizations were examined to identify the green. So, what is the green yardstick? So, out of 100 marks, there are different parameters to which the particular weight is given in the companies, and the how they have measured whether some companies are environmentally friendly or not. So, first parameter is existence of environment policy. There should be a separate environmental preservation policy. Weight is 15. Then organizational structure. Okay. Now in big cities like Pune, Mumbai, you find vertical structures. But even in this vertical structures, on the say gallery or something, you find lot of greenery. Okay. If you are traveling through bus or some four-wheeler, you can observe these days that the structure of the organization, it should include landscapes for green trees, lawns, and other things, which will, the structure may be vertical or flat, horizontal. But lot of greenery should be there. It carries 20 marks. Then target setting, okay, what you are planning in future, how to go protect the environment, what policies you are having, that is 10 marks. Training for environmental and safety. Okay. So your HR department should have training programs for environmental protection and safety. Then maybe some spiritual classes or yoga classes are conducted. Then how to protect the nature, environment is taught. Okay. How to plant trees, then system internal for awarding. Okay, so the one employee or one particular worker who is more eco-friendly or who is planting trees, watering trees, conserving trees, you give an award to him. Okay, this is carrying 5 marks. Then environmental performance. Okay. This performance is balanced between how much pollution the industry is causing and on the other hand, what efforts the industry is making to conserve the environment. Okay. This is how, if there is a balance between the two, if pollution is more, you will get less marks. And if preservation is more, you will get more marks. Okay. Then, environment, internal environmental reporting system. Okay. So, what was the temperature outside today, what temperature you have maintained, okay? And this is particularly day-to-day recording of temperature, pollution level, water contamination level, all these things, reporting system will carry 8 marks. Then system of environmental audits, once in 6 months or once in a year, an environmental audit is conducted, which is mandatory by the government. State government people will come and conduct the industry audit regarding environment and see that the industry is not causing harm to people around in the city. Okay. Then next is, this audit is carrying weight of 12. Then disclosure of information form and content. Okay. So you should give a mandatory disclosure of all the information which is asked during the audit. Okay. And see, rainwater harvesting these days industries are doing. Then disposition of waste. How we are disposing the waste. Then planting of trees. All these, what activities you are doing to conserve the environment. And you have to give correct information of all these. And voluntary standard codes adopted. Okay. So you should not be giving codes only to quality of raw material or how much wage salary you're paying, what standards you are adopting, what practices you're adopting for green environment. Okay. And
हेलो, हाँ हेलो, यस एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस मैम,
हाँ व्हाट
यस
हैपन
मैम,
मैडम, हैज स्टॉप्ड हर शेयरिंग और व्हाट, हैज शी लेफ्ट द मीटिंग?
यस मैम,
ओके, देयर माइट बी सम इश्यू, ऑल ऑफ यू बी इन द मीटिंग, आई विल आस्क, जस्ट अ मिनट. Okay, madam is joining. All of you be in the meeting only. And ask some questions in between. Give response.
Hello, am I audible, students?
Yes, ma'am.
And I think I'll have to share the screen once again.
Yes.
Yes, so we were discussing about largest companies, okay, in India, which are adopting green initiatives. So these are the 10 companies, okay. You can just have a look at it. Larsen & Toubro, Maruti Udyog, Hero Honda, HPCL, Bharat Heavy Electricals, Castrol India, Dabur India. Okay, these are some companies which are adopting green initiatives. And next slide talks of India in the 21st century. Okay, so environmental concerns and economic goals are often at odds. Okay, economic goals means business profits. So these are two contradictory things, environmental concern is given less weightage, but economic goals are on top. Okay, profit making is on top. As the population increases, the demand for electricity and transportation goes up. If such demands are met, air and water pollution would increase. Okay, so any electricity generation is not easy. There is a lot of, if you want to generate hydroelectricity, a lot of water resources are required. And when you are generating, water gets contaminated. Okay? Even though electricity is essential for economic development, the Indian government did reduce the number of inefficient coal-fired plants and decrease the subsidies on low-quality coal. See this special economic zones where MIDCs are established. There the government is giving a lot of subsidies to industry in terms of electricity charges, okay, and other resources they are charging at subsidized rate. But if the industries are not adopting environmental conservation practices, then the subsidies are stopped for these industries, especially industries utilizing coal as resource in the manufacturing process. Okay. The government also used market mechanisms such as granting of permits and reduction in taxes to encourage companies to implement pollution control measures. Okay. So these are all strategies adopted by state government and central government to minimize the pollution. And in fact, if you are not adopting pollution control measures or energy conservation measures, you are charged fine by the government. Okay? It also developed environmental standards for both products and processes. Okay? So, this is how the government of India is going to take certain initiatives to have control over the natural environment in India. Okay, so this is one part. Now in your syllabus, we talk of business ethics and environmental values. So what is environmental ethics and values? So it is the field dedicated to understanding human responsibilities with regard to natural resources. So this will be useful for you to write the exam. So this is particularly relationship between human beings and natural resources, you should remember, as it applies to the world of business. Environmental ethics is centrally concerned with the impact that a company's activities have upon the natural world. Okay, so companies should have favorable activities to protect the natural world. Okay, now what is environmental ethical values? So environmental ethics helps define man's moral and ethical obligation towards the environment, water, air pollution, the depletion of natural resources, loss of biodiversity, destruction of ecosystems, and global climate change are all part of environmental ethics. Okay, so if questions are asked in exam on environmental values, so you need to protect all these things. Your values are to protect water contamination, air pollution, depletion of natural resources, okay, which are getting exhausted. So destruction of ecosystem, these are all, protection of all these things are environmental values. Okay. Now next we are going to see pollution. This is also part of your syllabus. Pollution and resource depletion. Okay. So these are the two major threats to environment in modern society. So first we are going to see what is pollution. The undesirable and unintended contamination of the environment by human activity, such as manufacturing, waste disposal, burning fossil fuels, etc. Okay, so this is pollution is generally done because of human activity unnaturally. So manufacturing of processes in the industry, waste disposal, emission of carbon by vehicles, okay, then burning wood, fossil fuel, okay. So this is the cause of pollution. And what is resource depletion? It is different from pollution. The consumption of finite or scarce resources, it is called as depletion, means degradation or reduction of natural resources which are scarce, like water resource, forest resource, etc. The dimensions of pollution and resource depletion. Resource depletion is the consumption of resources faster than it can be replenished. Means if you cut 100 trees, growing of 100 trees again will take time, but cutting is happening more faster. So it is called consumption is faster than replacing those trees. Okay, that is resource depletion. Then natural resources are commonly divided between renewable resource and non-renewable resource. Which are the non-renewable resources? Mineral depletion, coal or other minerals, okay? Then oil depletion and deforestation. These are the three forms of depletion. Then pollution and resource depletion. Environmental damage is damage or harm done to environment that threatens the welfare of all living beings. Okay, threats to the environment come from two sources, pollution and resource depletion. Environmental damage inevitably threatens welfare of human beings as well as plants and animals. Okay, all living beings have a threat from pollution and resource depletion. Threats to the environment come from two sources, pollution and resource depletion. Now we have to see ethics in particularly pollution control. Okay, so what measures can be taken for control of pollution? So with increasing efficiency in energy use. Okay, see, these days if you see the environment around you, you'll find more of solar energy being used in industry, or maybe even for domestic purpose, household cooking, okay, for lighting, LED, different kind of lighting purpose. Many new innovation techniques are coming out of solar energy. So this is basically conserving the normal electricity and making use of this renewable energy as solar energy. So this will help basically to have control, okay, over or conservation of energy resource. Then use of environment friendly fuel resources. Now can you quote example of environment friendly fuel resources? Yes, any one of you? Which are environment friendly fuel resources?
Solar energy.
Huh?
Natural gases.
Biogas, yes. This can be environment friendly fuel energy, because this is emitting, biogas is emitting less of carbon. Okay, good. So this is the second way to control pollution. Then third, in the agricultural sector, pollution preservation approaches include reducing the use of water and chemical inputs. Okay, so these days in agriculture, you are very happy to see big tomatoes and big say brinjals and other vegetables, but we are making use of chemicals, hybrid seeds. Okay, and many people in agriculture, they waste lot of water. Okay, so proper use of water resources, irrigation facilities and chemical inputs will basic for, in terms of fertilizer. Okay, this will also help to reduce soil erosion. Okay, and control the pollution. Then next is adoption of less environmentally harmful pesticides or cultivation of crop strains with natural resistance to pest. And see, pest control activities, they are very harmful. Okay, now it is said that if you want to conserve the quality of soil, black soil, this particular worms or insects, they should be moving in the soil. But what pesticides do is they will kill this natural worms and insects, and the quality of the soil will be deteriorating day by day, and this will again cause soil erosion and soil pollution. Okay, so on one side, excess use of this pesticide is also not good, and it is harmful. Excessive use of this fertilizers and pesticides will deteriorate their natural environment. Okay, and pest control techniques. See, in your houses also, you are now giving those sprays to have pest control, but it is very poisonous. It is harmful for our skin. Okay, and many a times if you inhale pest control activities, and you may also fall unconscious. Okay, so this is causing pollution from agriculture and protection of sensitive areas. Okay, so like chemical Bhopal gas tragedy, these are all very sensitive chemical industries. We have to take lot of protection to control the pollution. Okay, so this is one way to control pollution. Then in the industrial sector, like MIDCs and all, example of P2, pollution preservation. P2 means pollution and preservation practices include. So earlier we have seen for agriculture, now we have to see for industry. So in industry, it is called as P2 practice. Modifying a production process to produce less waste. Okay. So in production process, there can be continuous improvement. Okay. So you talk of TQM. Okay. Then you talk of Kaizen, Six Sigma, where measures are taken to improve the production process continuously with minimum wastage. Okay. Six Sigma is a technique to minimize the wastage. Then using non-toxic or less toxic chemicals as cleaners or degreasers and maintenance chemicals. Okay, so just to see that the floor is looking clean, you use very toxic chemicals, okay, like acids and all. So this is also causing industrial pollution. Then implementing water and energy conservation practices like rainwater harvesting, okay, and then using of particularly bathroom water and toilet water for this gardening and other things. These are water conservation practices, and energy conservation is so use of solar energy and other things. Windmills and other things. Then reusing material such as drums and pallets rather than disposing of them as waste. See, if you are disposing more and more plastic into the environment, it is going to cause harm to the environment. Rivers are going to get blocked. Okay, so this is particularly reusing of material rather than dumping it into rivers and particular environmental places. In homes and schools, examples of P2 practices include using reusable water bottles instead of throwaways. Okay, so generally these days children are preferring steel bottles or copper bottles rather than plastic bottles, which can be washed and reused. Automatically turning off lights when not in use. This is also a conservation of environment, less use of electricity, and repairing leaky fan sets and hoses. Means your taps and all, when they are leaking, you have to repair them immediately, and switching to green cleaners. Okay, so many of the liquid soaps and all, they are prepared from natural particular plants and other things. So you can make use of this eco-friendly soaps, toiletries, instead of going for chemical soaps. Okay, so this is particularly the ways to conserve the energy and protect the environment. Now, last part of your chapter is ethics of conserving deplorable resources. Okay, so deplorable means which are going to get exhausted. How to conserve these resources? So you have to follow basic three pair principles. Okay, so for conservation, so first is justice and sustainability. So justice and sustainability, there is a principle in ethics called distributive justice. Okay, so whatever are the resources available in the environment, you basically, the distribution of these resources should happen naturally and in equal amount, okay, to different sectors of the industry. And use sustainability means use only how much required. Okay, so this is the principle of distributive justice and sustainability. You should be able to use this resources for many years, for longer period of time. Okay, that is sustainability. Then sufficiency and compassion. Okay, so what industries are doing? Yes, we should not fall short of raw material. So they are keeping on procuring raw material continuously to be self-sufficient, but you have to be compassionate, okay, towards the deplorable resources. You also have to have a thought process that what is my utilization of raw material on daily basis, weekly basis, monthly basis, what is my consumption, and how I'm exhausting the natural resource on this planet Earth. Okay, so this is particularly showing compassion towards the use of natural resources. Then next point is solidarity and participation. Okay, so what is solidarity? Whoever are this eco-friendly groups, solidarity means friendship. Okay, so companies have to make friendship with this energy conservation groups, and they have to participate in their activities, okay, to preserve the energy and save the resources on our planet Earth. Okay, so if you follow these three principles of distributive justice, sustainability, sufficiency and compassion, solidarity and participation. Solidarity means making companies should become friendly with this self-help groups, NGOs who are working for conservation of resources, and participate in their activities. So I hope you have followed these three principles. And next is the approach is the slide visible?
Yes, madam, visible.
Okay. Ethics of conserving this slide we have seen. Okay. The approach to natural resource conservation and preservation reflects three foundations of healing earth environmental ethics. Okay. So there is concept called healing earth. Generally, we heal our wounds, isn't it? If we get hurt or something, we apply Dettol or some antiseptic cream and we heal our body in a, okay? We are more concerned with our own body and self. But there is a concept called healing earth. So whatever degradation the industries are doing to Mother Earth, we have to basically find some way to heal this damage which is caused by the industries or human beings. So this concept, many NGOs are finding out ways how to preserve the good condition of environment on the earth. So this concept is called as healing earth concept. And the natural world basically has intrinsic value. So we have to understand as human beings that the natural world, that is water resources, forests, greenery, okay, and then air, okay, these are having some intrinsic value. Intrinsic means value which you cannot measure, okay. So extrinsic value can be measured, but these are invaluable resources. Natural resources are invaluable resources and they are having intrinsic value, means value which cannot be measured. The natural world has instrumental value also. Okay. What is instrumental value? Natural resources do not remain as they are. If they are processed, they can be converted into finished product and you can get better price for this finished products in the world. Okay. So this is instrumental value, and the value of environmental sustainability balances nature's intrinsic and instrumental values. Okay. So what is healing of earth? It is a balance between nature's intrinsic and instrumental value. Intrinsic is basically natural value, okay, as a particular natural resource, and instrumental value is processed value, okay. And if you want to basically have good environment and ethics in environment, okay, then you need to have a balance between intrinsic and instrumental values of the environment. And see, we have given many theories in environment and other things, but if you think today, this environmental issues and environmental ethics, these are very serious problems. Okay. See, sometimes next generations which are going to come, today if we think I want to see a dinosaur, it is not possible. Okay. The species has vanished. So by the time the next generations are coming, maybe some other animal species may not be available on earth, or basically the different natural resources, some minerals may get exhausted. Okay. So protecting them is a very big challenge today, and we have to learn to value water, which in day-to-day process we don't even realize that we are wasting water up to what extent. Okay. Then we need to preserve our surroundings, air around us for fresh breathing, and keep fresh air for the next generations. Okay. And this is our moral responsibility as citizens, and basically we have to have these practices in long run, not just for one day I have followed and I have forgotten. Okay, so this should become an habit. Energy conservation, environmental protection. Okay, even if tomorrow you pass out as engineers and join some industry, okay, you have to be careful and observe that basically whether it is a chemical industry, whether it is an electronic industry, you have to just be very cautious to see that environment is not getting degraded, and you have to be innovative enough to find out ways how I can protect my surroundings, how I can keep it clean, how I can keep it without pollution, air pollution, water pollution, how I can conserve the resources around me. Okay, this is particularly the values which the citizens have to adopt to protect our environment for tomorrow. Okay, so I hope some consciousness I have created with this talk, and you have followed various points in this talk. This was the last slide for the discussion of your syllabus chapter, but apart from this, if you have any general doubts in mind, we can discuss. I'll keep the forum open if you have any doubts. Yes, students, if you have not followed any point.
Yes, students, ask the question. It is over from your side, madam, or you want to yes. take some more points?
No. From my side, I have completed all the points. I think I finished a little early today, one and a half hours. But we can have some discussion if students are interested.
Yes. Okay, just one request is there, madam, from my side. So, have you worked in the corporate? I thought.
Yes.
So, can you little bit elaborate that things to students so that it will be helpful for them? Okay. Additional thing, because at time, as time is there, so I am requesting at 11th hour. Sorry for that.
Yes.
But
sure.
Okay, so you can share your experience, madam, so that okay. they will get some practical knowledge.
Okay, sure. First of all, students, as long as we are associated with our school or with education institute, colleges, we are very much in protective environment. Okay, but to share with you experiences of corporate, corporate world is very different from the world of being a student in education institutes. Here, you have protection from parents, your teachers, and if you have any issues or any doubts in mind, you immediately go and approach your teachers or your parents to solve the problem. But after completing your education and you take up a good job and join industry, there is nobody. You have to perform on your own. This is your real challenge. Okay, and in the corporate world, basically, things are changing very fast. Especially initially, immediately after independence, we had more focus on government organizations, like public sector organizations. So here, basically, the aspect was that you get a job, government job, and then you feel very much secured. Now I've got a government job, I'm getting a good package salary, and till retirement I have no worry. Okay, because at that time the government had a protective approach, a conservative approach. But as years have gone ahead, today we live in an environment where we are having industries in global approach. Okay, so we are operating in globalization where more focus is given to private industries. Okay, and private people are ruthless. Okay, they adopt hire and fire policy. Okay, so performance plays very important role. See, at university level, you may be a gold medalist. Okay, you have shown consistency. I don't say you don't be a gold medalist or you don't study, but see, many very intelligent students also, when it comes to performance in the industry, you need to really have practical approach. Okay, so what do you understand by this practical approach? See, as long as you are passing university exams, you are getting theoretical knowledge. That is also important. But along with this theoretical knowledge, corporate expects that you should have certain skills. Okay? So, knowledge plus skills. Skills may be in terms of expectation of the job. Okay? If you are going in electronic field, then your computer skills, IT skills, okay? These are basically day by day changing very fast. New softwares are being introduced. What you learn in college now may not be there when you work. So you have to basically be prompt enough on your toes to acquire the new technology that is entering the field of electronic telecommunication. So this is particularly knowledge plus skill plus the third aspect, which is very importantly judged in industry, is your attitude. Okay, so there are many academically very good people, or skill wise also they are good, and there are a lot of expectations, but when they join the industry they fail. Okay, why? Because it is because of their attitude part. Okay, so my advice would be always try to have a positive attitude of looking towards the industry. When you get a first job, maybe the salary is little less, but you don't crib. You tell yourself, being positive means I am at the best place. I am in the best company. This is just the beginning. Okay? So there will be better opportunities later. This is having positive attitude in mind. Okay? And maybe you should be a good team player. Having positive attitude towards your colleague. Okay, colleagues, adaptability is very important, confidence building is very important. So sometimes in my college I take sessions on soft skills also and personality development also. So good that madam told me to touch this point also. And see, ethics is also part basically important, your values and ethics. This is also a very important part which you have to follow, okay, at workplace. So generally values include, like I told you, being truthful, being honest, being committed, integrity, okay, towards the organization, being loyal towards the organization. All these aspects are judged at workplace apart from your knowledge and skills. So as a student now, basically you have to learn to have a good knowledge, basically keep on adding on skills, okay, different skills, do short-term courses, okay, then basically your attitude has to be developed, and basically try to inculcate soft skills, okay. Soft skills are playing a very important role, like, you know, your soft skills include your communication skill, okay, how you communicate with others. Your language should not be harsh, okay, in corporate. So you have to learn basic etiquettes like wishing good morning, good afternoon, okay. We take all these things very casually, but if one of your superior is passing just beside you, at least nodding your head and wishing him is very important. So all these small things, kindness is your body language, and other things are observed in corporate, okay. And definitely it is a different world, it is a challenging world. So I'm not scaring you, but along with, you don't be satisfied that I'm first in my class. This is basically enhancement of your academic knowledge. But if you want to be successful in life and successful in your career, then this particular aspect of soft skill plays very important role these days. When you are in informal environment at home or with your friends, your behavior may be different. You're very casual. But once you enter the corporate, all these things like being dressing well, okay, have a good haircut. Then if what is the dress code in the organization, whether you have to make use of formal dress code or what kind of, no, you wear a shirt and trousers formal, you put a nice belt, but you don't wear shoes, okay, then it does not give a formal look. So your dressing sense, then your communication with others, okay, if at all you are little bit weak in English or something, start practicing from now, because we are operating in global environment. And see, these days if you join a company like Reliance or something, it is a multicultural environment there. Your colleague may be somebody from Africa, one may be a Japanese, one may be a Chinese. So you need to accommodate their cultures, their languages, their food habits. So you have to basically start changing yourself a little bit. And English is a international language. So bare minimum is that you know your local language properly, and also you learn the international language, okay? So you will not face difficulty or problem. You, like we were discussing, there are two concepts, like, you know, a class of people, they are introverts, and a group of people, we call them as extroverts. So who are introverts? Who like to be with individually, they like to be alone, they don't like to mix up with people. So people who are having this kind of nature, they are called as introverts, okay? But there are a group of people who are extroverts, who open up very fast, who get mixed with new people. They change companies, they go to different environments, okay? And they mingle very fast. So these group of people, you have to try to be an extrovert if you want to be successful in corporate and be a good team player, okay? So adaptability is very important, and these kind of skills, if you are focusing, then definitely the corporate will accept you very fast, and you can build a successful career. Another thing I would like to highlight here is basically, once you become an engineer, or even if you do MS or say ME somewhere, your learning is not over. Okay, so the corporate environment is very dynamic. New technology is coming in the industry very fast. Okay, our times very different. So in public sector organization, whatever technology came new, the government used to implement it quite slowly. But today in private sector, the more you basically learn new things, be open to learning new things, and this is going to basically keep you updated with knowledge and skills. And there are different aspects in corporate, like annual appraisal is there, promotions are there, okay? So increments are there. So you have a dream, isn't it, in mind that I should have a successful career, I should get a good company, I should get a good job. So if you want to go in this particular direction, you have to work very hard, and this is the time, students. This is the best time to work on yourself, okay? So I would like to tell you here that basically prepare a daily timetable, okay? I wish I was physically in front of you, but as that is not possible, you prepare a daily timetable for you from now. Early in the morning, what is the time that you will get up? Don't be very harsh with yourself. You can get up at whatever regular time you are used to, okay? 6, 6:30, 7, okay? Then once you wake up, the 24-hour time cycle is not going to change, okay? So you have to do this activity, basically, you have to divide in two parts. Okay, first side is what you're doing presently. Okay, what you get up at say 6 a.m. Then presently what you're doing. Okay, that is 6 to 7 your morning course, then 7 to 8 some exercise. Okay, then what presently, or many may be watching television also, or just killing time, or sleeping till 9 o'clock. So what you are doing presently from 6 a.m. to till you go to college and attend, and till you go to bed. And second is an improved plan, okay, where you have to change and put that time to productive use, okay. Presently, I am sleeping till 9 o'clock, but from tomorrow, I'll get up at 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock to 6:30, 7, my morning course. Then after that, I will do some exercise. Okay? Corporate people, they are very health conscious. Okay? And they are very fit also. So to take care of yourself, you have to take up some exercise in the morning, then maybe your breakfast, then dressing up, coming to college. You may spend some time studying also early in the morning. So individually it will differ, and you prepare a improved timetable for yourself. Okay, then attending lectures, lunch hour, sometime in college also you can use for additional studies, utilization of library, and getting some more knowledge, okay? And basically focus on current news, corporate news. Okay, we are talking of being successful in corporate. So you have to know what companies, which are the successful companies, what they are doing. Okay, so general knowledge is very important from corporate point of view. So listen to some corporate news channel or read some journals, India magazines, Four Piece magazine, India Today. Okay, so Harvard Business Review is there. So many management magazines are there. You can read and get information. Okay, then coming home, little bit doing house course. It is not rigid that continuously you do exercise and study. You can find different ways, and some may like sports, some may like watching television. So sometime you can use for recreation also. And basically, again, studying and what time to sleep, what time to get up in the morning. All this has to be the ultimate objective of this exercise is that put yourself to constructive utilization of time. Okay, and see the change. Okay, definitely. Why? See, all of you, a batch of say 70, 80 students, all of you will become engineers. But out of all these 70, 80 or 100 people, few will reach the top. Okay, so I wish all will reach, all 100 will reach the top. You will all become successful. But generally it is observed that why there is a Ratan Tata out of his batch, or why there is an Ambani. Okay, why are these successful people leaders? They have, so it is all because of discipline in life, continuous upgradation. Okay, and basically giving your 100% to your work, to your job. Do whatever little job you do, do it with full interest. Okay, put your 100% efforts into it, and definitely I am sure that you will become successful in corporate. Okay, so these were some of the aspects, and you have to basically get yourself updated with manners and etiquettes. Okay, it is very important that in current corporate environment, okay, you've put your management dress, okay, formal dress, shoes, clean shaved, haircut, everything is there. But if your etiquettes and manners are lacking, okay, see, there are certain ways of behavior in the organization, like, you know, wishing your seniors, okay, then basically noise voice also. You should not disturb your department, your colleagues. Okay, there is a place for recreation, and there is a place for work. Don't make mobile a nuisance by using loud voice out of it, that it will disturb others in the department. Okay, and then friendly behavior with your colleagues. You all will be from different backgrounds, but especially you have to remember that you all are all Indians, and even if there are foreigners, cultures are different. You, as team players, you are ultimately working for the progress of your organization. Okay, so this is particularly very important, that etiquettes, manners, how you, supposing you are sitting in a group to have food, okay, You may be a vegetarian, pure vegetarian, but the person sitting beside you is a Chinese, is a non-vegetarian. So you are on the same table. So you cannot make faces when he's having his food. Okay. So in same aspect, in sensitive matters like religion aspect, you have to take care when you talk about other religions, okay, other dressing styles, okay. So give respect and take respect. This is a very important policy in corporate world, okay. And the principle of equality should be followed, okay. See, in ethics also, it is said that if you want good to happen to you, you should first do good to others. Okay? So, what you expect, the way you expect others to treat you, you have to first treat others in the same manner. So, this principle is very important from ethical point of view. So, students, you start working on yourself. Okay? First, I would say that early in the morning in your timetable you put, you will give time to read newspapers. Okay? Economic Times is very important. Times of India, improve your level. Okay? Then at this stage, start finalizing your career goals. Okay? What is my dream company? Where I would like to work? Okay? What is my dream job? And whether I want to continue studying, do PG after graduation, or I would like to take up a job. These are things you keep waiting and waiting till the end. But I would suggest that planning in advance will definitely give you a good guideline direction to go on the path of your career and become successful. Okay, so if you start working on yourself, reading newspapers, improving on your communication, improving on your soft skills, building on your confidence level, interacting, becoming extrovert, opening with your friends, you can form a group of 4 or 5 students. One will work on news awareness, one will work on improvement of communication, one will work on basically improvement of attitude, confidence, and all these things. So in a team, if you are trying to focus on yourself and make improvement, definitely you will find change in yourself and you will be prepared to face the corporate environment. So I think I've spoken a lot.
Yes,
on
yes,
this
madam.
Subject also.
Okay, okay. So actually, you were talking, means giving very good guidelines, so I didn't stop you.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you, madam. Just one
no,
request.
But there's no limitation of time or anything. If students have any questions in mind relating to this personality development and soft skills, mm-hmm. also, I will interact with them.
Yes.
If they have any questions, they can ask anything okay. related to ethics or the soft skills okay. or anything.
Okay, so that they will ask, madam. But just one request before that, as that protocol we have to do that. So I request you to just make your camera, video camera, just for 1 minute. And yes, students, you please give your feedback in the chat box. And if anybody want to ask the question, they are free to ask also. Okay. So, before giving vote of thanks, if you have to ask any question, you can ask.
Madam,
just a minute. Audumbar, wait 1 minute. Madam, you have to first stop your presenting. Then you can make your camera
on. Okay. Okay.
Okay, madam. Just a minute. ओके थैंक यू मैडम. हाँ यू कैन मेक इट ऑफ नो प्रॉब्लम. हाँ यस यू कैन गिव योर फीडबैक इन द चैट बॉक्स स्टूडेंट्स इस रिक्वेस्ट. ओके नाउ यू कैन आस्क द क्वेश्चन अवदुम्बर.
ओके मैम माय मैम माय क्वेश्चन व्हाट इज द मेन पर्पस ऑफ एनवायरमेंटल इथिक्स.
बेसिकली वेरी नाइस क्वेश्चन. बेसिक पर्पस ऑफ सी वी एज ह्यूमन बीइंग्स वी आर लिविंग ऑन दिस अर्थ. अर्थ इज वेरी नेचुरल ऑफ नेचुरल रिसोर्सेस. ओके लाइक वाटर रिसोर्सेस देन फॉरेस्ट ट्रीज विच गॉड हैज गिवन अस natural resources. To conserve this natural resources, ethics of environment is very important. Okay, what man is doing is he is cutting trees, he is utilizing raw material, okay, in industries, and he is moving towards development and progress, and he is being self-centered to earn maximum profit out of his industrial activity. But exhausting natural resources is not ethics. Okay, conservation of natural resources is very important, and that's why environmental ethics also becomes very important. I hope I have answered your question.
Yes ma'am.
Okay.
Thank
you, ma'am.
Anybody else? It's okay. Anybody else want to ask the question? They can. Okay. Anybody? Okay. So if you don't have any questions, I would go to the last part. Actually, madam, I am very thankful to you on behalf of our department and Sveriges College of Engineering for accepting the invitation and guiding the students, not only from syllabus point of view, but also you have given very simple guidelines for them, which are really helpful for their practical life as well as their personality development also. Okay, so in future also, I expect the same cooperation from your side. And as you told, that you are delivering the lectures based on this personality development point also. So in
yes.
future, or if we require, definitely I expect the same enthusiasm and your cooperation from your side, madam.
Definitely, definitely. No issues.
Okay.
Thanks. So okay. It was nice to be with you all, students and Sveri family. So even I look forward for more association with the institution.
Yes, yes.
And students. Okay.
Yes, madam. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank
very
you,
much.
Madam.
Okay.
Okay. So we will close the session here.
Yes, yes, sure.
So